Welcome to Hustle and Flow with Heather Hubbard, episode 157. Hi, I'm Heather Hubbard, and I was a litigator partner and practice group leader at an Am Law 200 firm. I know what it takes to rise to the top. I also know all too well the toll it can take on your personal life. So how do you shine bright without burning out? How do you embrace your ambition without selling your soul? You're listening to the Hustle and Flow podcast. Welcome back. I am your host, Heather Hubbard, and I am so excited to introduce to you today, Karen Sargent. So Karen and I chatted about a year ago, and then we were in one of those random places where I was like, do I know you? And we were able to connect the dots. We participated in a speaking program together. I got to know her, and she is amazing. And so I wanted to bring her on the podcast for you today. So Karen helps small business owners clear the choke points that throttle their businesses. I don't know about you, but I resonate with that. She helps seven-figure CEOs dramatically improve internal operations, boost team performance and satisfaction, and make smarter business decisions through metrics and analytics. She has a master's in political science and security policy studies. So get this. She worked at the Counterterrorism Center at the CIA for 8 years, and before that was in Silicon Valley in product management for QuickBooks for 6 years. So she credits these paycheck careers for teaching her how to lead teams under some pretty epic constraints. And so she now has her own consulting business, lives in Tucson, has an adorable little puppy that I love seeing pictures on Facebook. Karen, welcome to Hustle and Flow.
Thank you. What a great intro. Thanks.
Well, I have to say, when I first heard you speak and you were sharing, you know, I've not heard your entire speech, but I heard a little bit of it. And I secretly wondered, like, I didn't know if I should laugh or cry or be embarrassed because I thought maybe you had like been spying on me and you were like sharing all of my dirty laundry with the world.
Well, I'm glad to hear it resonated. And I think you are not alone, Heather. There's a number of you out there that are, you know, this is a growing pains problem. So only successful businesses really tend to have the, you know, those issues. And so you can pat yourself on the back a little bit because you've reached a place where those things are happening in your business. But yeah, you are definitely not alone.
All right, let's talk about what this is, the bottleneck, right?
Mm-hmm. Well,
certainly the CEO, right? So I'm going to let you take it from here because clearly you've got this down. But let's tell the listeners what we're talking about.
Yeah. So what I see is a phase of business problem, business growing pains. So this is how I came across this. So I noticed that most of my clients were coming to me at a similar time in their business with really similar pain points. And in a gist, lots of things were going well. You know, the things that you worry about at the very beginning of your startup, like, can I make a product that people want to buy? Can I sell it? You know, consistent sales, decent lead gen, all of those things that were challenges in the early part are working really well. But it's those successes that are causing some breakages inside the business. So it's actually the fact that so many widgets are flying out the door. It's that the ad hoc nature of getting them out the door is now what's troubling the business.
Yeah, you know, and I see this because I work with a lot of lawyers as well as a lot of entrepreneurs and others. And it seems like anytime, and maybe it's product-based businesses too, but anytime you have a service-based business where you are the expert, it's really hard to figure out how do you keep showing up as the expert while also managing the team, while doing all the things without lowering your customer service.
Absolutely. Yes. And if you remember, you know, back in they seemed like golden days, you know, when it was you and one BA and you guys were rocking the house. Like you got so much done. There was just, you know, you were jamming together. There was very little, you know, balls dropped between the two of you. And you just wonder, like, I keep adding headcount. And I'm the one that keeps getting more work on me and you can't like figure it out. Like how is all of these people that I've added to my headcount, how are they not taking work off my plate?
Right.
So Go ahead.
What do you think is the biggest issue there? Like, what's really going on?
Well, there is one single source. It sounds like there might be many things. You know, when they come to me, they talk about they're drowning in work. There's still all of these fire drills as a way of business. And when they delegate, they don't like the quality that they get back. And it sounds like many pain points, but there really is one single source. And the single source is them. It's like it's like in the horror movie, the call is coming from inside the house.
And so what is it that we're doing wrong?
So here's what I think is happening. So at these inflection points in business, right where we are, where the old challenges aren't the current challenges anymore, it's that the old way of doing things starts to cause problems. So what got you here isn't what's going to get you to the next level. And I call that old way of doing things the MacGyver toolkit, because it reminds me of the TV character. So like MacGyver, you know, has their hands in just about everything. They make the impossible possible. They're not even sure how it comes together, but it does. And they love working in the clutch. Like the clutch situations bring out the best.
Yep.
And also I like calling it MacGyver because it's a really positive thing, because these were once habits of success. This is how startups get to, you know, to the phase of business where they're actually, you know, getting a lot of widgets out the door. I mean, you have to have that kind of damn the torpedoes sensibility about you. The most successful entrepreneurs do. And so the most successful entrepreneurs are MacGyvers at heart. So this very effective set of practices for really young businesses, but if you think about it, MacGyver doesn't scale. That is not a recipe for expanding your business.
He does not have a team, does he? Not really. Okay,
no.
So how do we move beyond that? How do we still keep the scrappiness, right, that makes us a great business owner, but indeed scale?
Right. So like pretty much like any solution, there's some mindset work and then there's some actual practical things that you can be doing. The mindset piece is actually probably the toughest. You know, I think any tool that you try to put into your business will be defeated if the mindset work isn't there. I think there are some, especially for young entrepreneurs and these small businesses like yourself and all of the, you know, your colleagues and things, because they started as solopreneurs and they feel like the business is an extension of themselves, it's very personalized. Whereas in other startups with, you know, maybe outside funding and a board of directors and things, it doesn't maybe feel as personal. But when there is a personal connection with the business, there is a lot of just habits and lack of desire to give up control at the end of the day. They know what the solution is. It's not that anyone's unaware that they're the bottleneck, right? And they also know what the solution is. It's just very hard to make it happen.
Okay. One of the issues that you raised was that people say, if I delegate, I'm not happy with the work product.
Yes.
So what is the solution to that? Is it lowering your standards? Is it letting go? Is it better training? Is it who you hire? What would be your feedback on that particular issue?
Yeah. And that is the number one practical fix. What we're going to talk about is probably the biggest practical fix that you can put into your business. And it depends a little bit on what's wrong. So let's dig into how do we figure out, you know, what's the diagnosis, doctor? So lots of people describe it as there's sort of two choices. One is to be constantly involved, or two, to back off but be disappointed. So neither works, and both tend to drive owners crazy. So when you're stuck, when your choices are constant involvement or disappointment, you need to pull back and look at the type of guidance that you're giving your team. And of course, there's two ways that this can be going haywire. One is it's too vague. Too vague for a team to meet expectations when they're working on their own. And then sometimes you have the opposite problem where you're teaching experts, you know, you're sort of riding herd on people with high expertise, maybe even more expertise than you have, and you're trying to micromanage them. Neither of them works, but what's important here is that you match the guidance to the team that you have.
I like that. So do you feel as though most CEOs have the ability to provide clear guidance, or do they need a coach or an in-between or someone else?
Yes. So perfect. I advocate for finding what gap is on your team. There likely is one, and filling it. So there's two ways that there can be a gap on your team. So I like to use a metaphor. It's a restaurant metaphor. So let's imagine that the CEO is the owner of a hot new restaurant and they designed every dish on that menu. Let's say they've developed a new dinner entree and they write it up. They head to the restaurant, they go to the kitchen and they walk up to the grill guy who's going to be cooking this new dish. And they love their grill guy, right? He does excellent work. And you hand over the recipe card. And then it's like, record scratch. Like, are you sure this is the right handoff? Like, he's going to be the guy who will cook your new dish. But is this the right pass off to be, you know, to be handling there? I mean, the answer is no. You know, making the dish once is not the same as making it 50 times a service. You have to think about sourcing the food, prepping the food, you know, getting the right people in on the early shift so that everything's sort of set up. There's just a lot of extra work to be broken out and figured out, even though you have a dish and you have a recipe card. And so you can lecture that grill guy all day on taking ownership or stepping up or, you know, but he's really there to rock out his 4x3 part of the kitchen and to cook burgers perfectly every time. He is not the guy who's going to take a recipe card and figure out what the rest of the kitchen is doing, including himself, in order to make that happen. So like there's two lessons here. One is you don't implement ideas. You implement plans. And just that realization alone can be a sea change for some people. Mm-hmm. And then the second lesson is the fundamental service that's happening here is one of translation. So translating ideas into plans. And it's this translation skill set that tends to be missing on a team. So earlier in the business, the translation either got done ad hoc by the CEO or another team member, or they just muddled along. But these are roles that need to be formalized as the business scales. And being at this inflection point is the time is now to get one of those, to get that gap filled on the team.
And do you find that that gap tends to be a similar type of role, or can it be lots of different roles?
It tends to be one of two. And sometimes it can be pushed into one actual person, but there tends to be two separate ways. So when I work with clients, we run a whole diagnostic on the team that covers a number of different variables. But when we think about just the crux of the matter, the translation effort goes from strategy to goals. So can you hear a strategy and set goals? Can you hear a goal and make up the projects that would deliver that goal? Projects into list of tasks, and then can you complete them on time? So that's kind of how strategy goes all the way down to what are people doing each day? And there's two main translation positions. So a project manager is an expert on turning projects into tasks and making sure the trains run on time, which is so valuable on a team. So it lets our implementers, like our grill guy, just be the grill guy.
So the grill guy's just doing the task.
Yes, he's the, you know, he's the implementer, the execution guy. And sure, he troubleshoots. When something at his station goes haywire, he will solve it and probably solve it at an expert level. But he isn't the guy who necessarily figures out the SOP or what the work is, you know, and how everyone fits together. You know how like a, even to use the same restaurant metaphor, you know, a dish has a number of different, it has the grill station, it has the, I don't know, the salad station, and just all sorts of things come on the plate at the very last minute. There's an orchestra there. Somebody needs to be conducting that orchestra, to mix metaphors, but it's not each individual station person. It's the person who sits on top of them. That can be a project manager.
And what's the other role?
The other role is slightly up that chain. It is the integrator or the COO. And that's the person who translates strategies and goals into the actual projects. And so it's a, you know, almost a right-hand person to the visionary CEO. This is why you have, you know, lately in the last several years, we talk about visionaries and integrators, and we talk about them as a team. It lets the visionary be the visionary, and the integrator is the one that kind of takes the ideas and says, I know how to make a blueprint out of this. I know what should be happening. And then they sort of parcel it into projects or goals and then hands them off to the project manager.
So depending on, right, because we have a lot of listeners and those who are like truly in the online space, they're going to be familiar with these terms. For those who are in professional services, let's say they're an accountant, they are a lawyer, right? Something like that. This still relates, right? So, but do they tend to have different names in that corporate arena? I'm wondering, is it like a business manager or something else?
I think so. So project managers can be business managers, sometimes office managers. They are the, think of them as the air traffic controller or kind of the train scheduler, you know, maintainer, which are really awkward terms, but I think people can kind of conceptualize. There's always that one person who's the glue that knows, you know, that the 35 things that all need to happen by this afternoon all kind of happen and keeps her finger on the pulse. So those people are what I would call project managers who are making sure that either the burger goes out of the kitchen right or that the trains run on time.
Mm-hmm. And then like the integrator or COO, because this is what, it's so interesting because we tend to think that we're very different in our industries, but I find that we're often very, very similar. It's just the words that we use around it. So if someone is going from, right, like they're just a solo, like we said, they're a solopreneur. Yep. Whether it looks like an online business or whether it truly is like a service-based expert business. Because as you're growing your team, you generally can't like put a million people in place at once. Let's say it is you and you've got the assistant or you and another, you know, expert that's helping you out. What is the next one? Should you put in the integrator COO or should you put in the project manager? Is there a perfect formula? What do you look for in that?
Yeah, I don't think there's a perfect formula and I think it can differ, but my sense is the project manager would likely come first. And that's when the span of control, when it's not the two of you executing anymore, because then you have maybe a specialized graphics person, or maybe you have, I don't know, someone who's working your email marketing or somebody else. And there seems to be a lot of just the moving parts tends to, just the sheer number of them tends to increase. And when those get unwieldy, that's when a project manager steps in and starts making sure that all of those things are happening.
Yeah. I mean, I have to say that was my big pain point, right? A year ago was I was no longer just the expert, but as we started adding team members, I found myself being the air traffic controller. And I was actually using that terminology. I was like, I'm flying the plane and I'm the air traffic controller and we're going to crash.
It feels that way. There are people, I also think that air traffic controlling by a visionary is one of the most awkward and ill-fitting kind of secondary roles that you could do. It probably is very fatiguing. It just is not your genius zone whatsoever. And there are people like that for whom that is their genius zone. And I love when I hook up with them because I admire them.
All right. So let's say you're now like, okay, some people are listening. They're like, oh my gosh, this is my problem. So they're like, I need an air traffic controller. So someone comes in there. At what point do you then expand to the, and now I need an integrator and COO?
Right. So the work of the integrator is to, you know, take maybe strategy and turn them into the right annual goals and the quarterly goals, prioritizing, evaluating new ideas as they come up. And I think earlier in the business, either the CEO is managing them on themselves or working with a mentor or coach or a mastermind group, because all of those can help a business owner shape what they want the next moves to be. So they absolutely can play those roles. And so my thoughts are, is that you'll know when your outside help, like a coach or a mentor, it's just not sufficient to meet the need. It's just more initiatives are being fielded quicker, and the CEO just needs way more support to actually offload vision into plans, ideas into plans. And that's when you'll need somebody at least part-time to be at your side to help you think those things through.
All right. So one of the things that you talked about, and I think it actually goes hand in hand with all of this, is the letting go of control, right? Because when you bring someone in that is now helping you take your strategy and turn them into goals and stuff like that, that can feel like, oh my gosh, scary. And what I have found, even as my team grows, I'm trying to let go. And yet sometimes I will pull it back in, right? And it shows up in many different ways, but I've heard you call it the fire drill. And so I would love, I mean, I know trying to watch our time, but I would love if you would actually address this, because I think so many people are going to relate and could really hear your thoughts on that, on what it's like to, you know, stop with the fire drills, and also how you let go as you're expanding the team.
Yeah, it's so hard. It really is. Honestly, when people, every client, I'm nearly sure of this, every client that comes to me to a person has said that they're tired of the constant fire drills. They say it, their team says it. That's the exact phrase they use. So nobody likes fire drills. But that's actually not the case, because when we start working together and implementing some of these new ways of managing, they still find ways to engineer fire drills back into the business, like making an 11th hour choice, or that just sort of plunges the team into chaos. So here's what I think. I think at the root of it, they're in love with their fire drills. They're just secretly in love. They're just not interested in breaking up with them. And that's how ingrained the MacGyver habits are, or how much they value them as a part of their identity.
Yep.
So it just comes down to a choice. You know, fire drills won't work at scale. And so you can chase the adrenaline because it brings you personal gratification, or you can choose to value something different. That sounds really almost clinical. That is the crux of the matter. But of course, it takes a lot of internal work to, you know, these are ingrained habits. And I have them myself. Like, I have my own MacGyver tendencies as a COO, and I war with them every week with just trying to figure out how I stay above the fray and delegate versus gap fill. For me, my MacGyver tendency is to gap fill, just because I tend to know the technology, and sometimes delegating it to somebody is going to take just as much work than doing it myself. And I'm doing the same habits that I'm trying to coach my clients into not doing. So it's difficult. I can say that firsthand.
I love this. I have two thoughts. One is, I was actually just working with a coach this morning, and I was like, I use that technique all the time. It never occurred to me to do it. And this is why we have to hire other people, right? We all have these issues, but we're too close to it when it's ourselves. But the other one is, do you want to stay scrappy and small? Or do you want to let go of the scrappiness and grow? And it really is a choice. I love that you're saying that.
It is a choice. It is a choice. Some people value the scrappy and just think it's fun. And I mean, that's the beauty of, you know, working for yourself. If the boss, you know, whatever, if you as the boss can engineer whatever lifestyle you prefer. But if you are going to grow, it will be a process to let go of the control and let go of, you know, that saying, don't sweat the small stuff, is you start to have to understand if something's going to impact conversions or not. Yeah. And sometimes I actually ask my clients to say out loud, you know, as they're about to, like, you know, jump in and tell them that the wrong color blue was used in the image, you know, is this going to impact conversions or not? And to try their very best to stay on the things that are going to impact sales, conversions, major happiness issues with their current clients and things like that. It just has to be a big enough lever for them to be thinking about swooping in and having a moment with.
Oh, I know. It's like my biggest pain point. As you're saying this, it's like my heart hurts. I'm like, oh, totally get it. What matters and what doesn't. And that's 100% where I am right now, is trying to let go of what does not really matter at the end of the day, even though my mind thinks that it matters. If I'm being honest, a lot of things don't. And I think, at least my listeners, a lot of us, we suffer from perfectionism, right? We have very high standards. We expect a lot from ourselves. And so as we grow our teams, right, we really do, it's kind of like you were talking about with mindset, we have to dig deep and look at some of those demons, because it's not just us that, you know, we're impacting, it's the entire team.
Yes, agreed. And I think perfectionism and the fact that they self-identify with the business very, very strongly. So if the business has an error or a typo or something is not quite right, it feels very, very personal. Yep. And I think, you know, perfectionism is one of those words that sounds kind of virtuous, but it's a really heavy burden, and it could be quite a piece of armor to drag around. And that's usually fear-based and like fear of vulnerability and things like that. I like the term striving for excellence much better than perfectionism, because mm-hmm. perfectionism comes with that error-free connotation. And just think about a kitchen and just all the different, like, you're never going to be error-free. And if you want to manage to that good luck to you. You're going to burn through your headcount because it's really hard to work for that kind of person. And you're not going to be able to scale because scaling with a really, really small error rate is just too tough. So you need to find what's okay and what's not okay. I mean, there's certain errors that really never should creep in, but focusing on those and letting the rest just process improvement, strive for excellence. But when they happen, just sort of forgive them and move on.
This is the question I ask myself every day. I'm trying to think of when I made this my mantra, but it's what do you want more? What do you want more? Yeah. So for those out there listening who are like, they may or may not be loving what you're saying, but they're identifying with what you're saying. How can they learn more? How can they find you? How can they reach out?
Well, my website is KarenSargent.com. And the only trick there is to spell my last name correctly. I'm there and I'm on Facebook and I'm not really on many of the other social channels, but Facebook and my website are the best places.
And so that you guys know, Sargent is S-E-R-G-E-A-N-T. And we will put that link as well in our show notes and on the website. Any last parting words, Karen, before we go?
Yeah, just one thing. So when CEOs feel this kind of growing pains, these phase of business problems, it really feels like they've bumped up against an upper limit in their business. And I just want to encourage anyone who feels this way, those are not real upper limits in your business. They're just growing pains to work through and sort through. And I urge you to not get stuck and to work through them because there's no reason that these should be upper limits on your business. The upper limits should come from the industry and from your willingness of customers to purchase your products, you know, all of those kind of sales and marketing and industry issues, not from your ability to deliver well.
I love that. That's going to resonate with a lot of people that I work with, I know, and it resonates with me as well. Karen, thank you so much for coming on the show. This was so helpful, so valuable. I really appreciate your time.
Thank you. I love being here.
For show notes, downloads, and other free resources, and to keep the conversation going, head on over to hustleandflowpodcast.com. See you there.